to Francisco from the Netherlands, I guess, who is going to tell us about Fourier, about completely bounded polynomials and classical simulation of quantum algorithms. The floor is yours.
Yeah, thanks, Richard. So yes, I'm going to talk about this maybe a bit technical looking title, which is Influences of Fourier Completely Bounded Polynomials and Classical Simulation of Quantum Algorithms. But don't get afraid, I'm going to explain a bit what is like the high level idea and what is the motivation, and then I'm going to dive a bit into the technical details of the result. So the question I want to understand is if we need or not quantum, if we need a structure to obtain quantum speedups. And let me be more precise, I'm going to care about exponential quantum speedups in the query model. So first of all, I'm going to introduce you the query model. In the query model, what we're going to care about is to compute Boolean functions in this talk. And Boolean functions are functions defined on a domain of the Boolean hypercube that also take Boolean values. And here, for me, Boolean is minus 1, 1. And the goal in the query model is to try to compute the Boolean function without knowing much of the input. So the cost of our algorithms are going to be the number of information that you get of the input. In a classical world, the information you can get is a bit, so an entry of the input. And then what we are going to say is that when we ask for a piece of information, we are going to query one entry of the input. And we are going to do it through this oracle map. If we want to talk about the same but in the quantum model, the natural way to do this is to say that we, instead of having a map that is like this, we make it a gate, an oracle gate, that maps the eighth element of a fixed basis in a Hilbert space to the eighth element times the eighth entry of the input. So somehow this generalizes the classical oracle, and the quantum world is going to be more powerful because you can do things in superposition, use complex spaces, and then obtain quantum speedups. And maybe like to have a pictorial depiction of what the query model is, you can think that you have a computer that is very powerful and limited power, but the input is held by a genie that has his precious input, and the way that the algorithm works is the computer asks some information about the input, and the genie replies. And the cost of your algorithm is the number of rounds of this questions that you make to the oracle. Maybe to have yet more pictorial depictions, a classical query algorithm can be thought as a randomized decision tree, where a decision tree is something like this, and you have to read a decision tree like this. First, you query the fourth entry of the input, and if it's minus one, then you output one. If it's one, you output three, and you go on. And on the other hand, a quantum query algorithm would be an alternation of fixed unitaries with these oracle gates that access the input, and at the end, you measure. If you measure one, you upset. If you measure zero, you reject. And these are like the two things that we want to compare, and in fact, a lot of work has been done to compare these two models of computing. The very well-known case of the total Boolean functions, where the domain is the total Boolean hypercube, there we know that the classical query complexity is upper bounded by the quantum query complexity up to some polynomial power, the power 4. So this means that for total Boolean functions, we can obtain super polynomial quantum speedups. We can obtain polynomial quantum speedups, such as the Grover algorithm shows. And also, what we know is that for very structured problems, for problems where the domain is a very little corner of the Boolean hypercube, what happens is that you can obtain super polynomial quantum speedups, exponential quantum speedups, such as the algorithm given by Simon. What we don't know is what happens in between. In between, we do not know any example of a problem where you can obtain a super polynomial quantum speedup which cannot be simulated. So, as we have tried a lot to find quantum speedups in any regime, what we believe is that if we have not found them, what happens is that they don't exist. So, the belief is that you need a lot of structure in order to obtain super polynomial quantum speedups. This is a folkloric conjecture that dates back from the 90s, and Aaronson-Ambainis proposed a maybe more precise formulation of this conjecture, and that conjecture is that given a query quantum algorithm, is believed that there is a classical query algorithm that simulates the quantum one with a small error almost everywhere, making only a polynomial number of extra queries. And that is a conjecture that we are going to care about. And what Aaronson-Ambainis tried to do is say, okay, quantum algorithms are a bit complicated, but they have a structure. Maybe we can like use that structure and say something about simulating quantum algorithms. And what they wanted to use is the fact that the output of a quantum query algorithm is a polynomial. That is a polynomial that is bounded on degree by twice the number of queries that the algorithm makes, and bounded on the infinity norm, meaning that the absolute value of the values that the polynomial takes on the Boolean per cube is upper bounded by one. And here, with the output of a quantum algorithm, with the output of a quantum algorithm, I mean that I'm considering the difference between the acceptance probability and the reluctance probability of the algorithm, which is going to be always upper bounded by one because these are two complementary probabilities, upper bounded in absolute value. So again, to have a pictorial depiction, this means that the T-query quantum algorithms are in particular polynomials that are bounded on degree and bounded on the infinity norm. So we have some structure that makes quantum algorithms some very well studied objects, like we know a lot about polynomials. Maybe quantum algorithms are a bit more difficult. So what Aaronson-Ambainis proposed was to say something about simulating polynomials, which would imply something about simulating quantum algorithms. And that thing that they proposed to say was then now known as the Aaronson-Ambainis conjecture, which states that given a polynomial with those properties, a bound on the degree, a bound on the infinity norm, then it's believed that the maximum influence of the polynomial is lower bounded by a polynomial depending on the variance and the inverse of the degree of the polynomial. I'm going to explain now what are like the technical parts of this statement. First of all, let me recall that a polynomial defined on the Boolean per cube can be expanded as a linear combination of multilinear monomials, and this expansion is known as the Fourier expansion, and these coefficients are the Fourier coefficients. And the Fourier analysis is pretty useful, and for example, tells us that the variance, which is the average change of the polynomial when you change the input, is equal to the sum of the squares of the Fourier coefficients. You can also talk about a kind of variance when you only care about changing one of the entries of the input, which is the influence. If you care about what is the average change of the polynomial when you change the ith variable, then you also get a nice formula through Fourier analysis, which is that the square of the Fourier coefficients that belong to, that have that variable in them, give you the influence. And the maximum influence is just the maximum number in all influences of the polynomial. So this result is saying that if you have a polynomial with these characteristics, what you know is that there is a variable that is going to be responsible of a lot of the change of the polynomial. This is the change given by the most influential variable, and this is the change of the total change of the polynomial. And how can we use this to simulate polynomials? Well, let me recall you that if we can simulate these polynomials, we can also simulate quantum algorithms. So now, if we have one polynomial of this, what we can do is say, if we want to simulate it with a classical query algorithm, is first we query the most influential variable, and after querying the most influential variable, we restrict our polynomial to whatever we have queried, and we get, again, a polynomial that is bounded on the infinity norm and bounded on degree. So we can iterate again. And after a polynomial number of iterations of this process, we are going to get something whose variance is very low. So we can just output the expectation, and that is going to be correct almost everywhere with high probability. So if this was true, then we would have the simulation conjecture that quantum speedups need a structure. So from now on, we are just going to care about how to solve something like this. Okay? And now let me argue by intimidation that this is not only an interesting problem, but super hard. And to do that, I want to show you that these are the works that have been done to try to prove this Aaronson-Ambainis conjecture. And I want to say that all these works either are reductions or very particular cases and don't really say something super interesting about the Aaronson-Ambainis conjecture. And as you can see, there is like a lot of like famous names. So if famous people have tried to solve this and they have not really managed, it must be not only an interesting problem, but also a bit hard. But what I want to talk about is to try to tackle the problem in another way, with a bit of different approach. So as I said, T-query quantum algorithms are in particular polynomials bounded on degree and on the infinity norm. But we can be a bit more precise. thanks to the works of Aaronson-Ambainis, Briët and Palazuelos, Grimlin-Arendt, and mine, what we know is that the T-query quantum algorithms are not, this inclusion is not a strict that was known before, but we can characterize the T-query quantum algorithms in terms of some polynomials that are going to have the same bound on the degree, but a different bound on the norm. So now we are going to have a bound on a Fourier complete bound or norm, which I'm going to introduce in a few slides, which is always bigger than the infinity norm. So this set of polynomials are going to be more structured than the outer set here. And that is going to be useful because for us, the only case where the Aaronson-Ambainis conjecture is relevant for us who work on quantum is the case where of these polynomials, because those are the ones that correspond to quantum algorithms. So our idea is going to be to relax the Aaronson-Ambainis conjecture and substitute the infinity norm condition for the Fourier complete bound norm condition, and thus work with a weaker conjecture that might be easier to prove, and try to say something about the quantum speedups. And I want to mention that this was not the first work on this line. The work of Bansal, Sinha, and the Wolf that was presented at QIP this year also tried to tackle the Aaronson-Ambainis conjecture on another case of quantum algorithm on this way. And I'm not going to go into the technical details of this work, but I just want to say that this idea of using the extra structure of quantum algorithms to say something about the Aaronson-Ambainis conjecture was already tried before. And I also want to say that we can reprove the result of Bansal, Sinha, and the Wolf in a more elegant way, maybe, or shorter, and obtain meter constants. So now let me talk about the Fourier complete bound norm. And to do that, I have to be a bit technical, so sorry. And first thing I have to do is to introduce high dimensional bits. So imagine that you have a bit string that is like just a collection of n minus one and ones, and you pick two sets of variables. And if those sets of variables have the same elements that appear a odd number of times, then what you are going to get is that the product of these entries of the corresponding entries of the bit string are going to be the same. And the reason is that as everything is minus one and one, all the squares are going to cancel, and these two things are going to be the same. Maybe to have an example, we just can say that x1, x2, x3, x1, x1 is going to be the x2, x3, x1, x4, x4. So these two are going to square to one, these two are going to square to one, and everything commutes, so these two things are going to be equal. And you can kind of extend this notion of scalar bits of dimension one to higher dimensions. And the way that we want to do it, as we are going to see later why, is to pick two vectors and a string of matrices and say that they are going to be a d-dimensional bit if they satisfy the same relations. So you multiply the matrices, you sandwich them with the vectors, and if they have the same properties as a normal bit string, then you call that a d-dimensional bit string. Okay, so why we care about d-dimensional bit strings? To do that, to show that, we are going to first recall that the infinity norm is the supremum of the evaluations of the polynomial on scalar bit strings, on dimension one bit strings. And we are going to recall the Fourier expansion. And once we have the Fourier expansion, we can not only evaluate the polynomial on bit strings, but we can also evaluate the polynomial on high dimensional bit strings. And the norm that we get is what I call the Fourier complete Wander norm, which is always bigger than the infinity norm, because now we are not only evaluating the supremum on one-dimensional bit strings, we are evaluating the supremum on high-dimensional bit strings too. And why we care about this? Well, the thing is that this is the correct norm to talk about when you are talking about quantum query algorithms. And that is because of the works of Arunachalam, Briët, Palazuelos, Grimlin-Arendt, and mine. And why is the correct one? Because as I announced before, this norm gives you a perfect characterization of quantum query algorithms, meaning that something is a T-query quantum algorithm if its output is bounded on the Fourier complete bound norm and bounded on the degree. So now what we have is that we don't have to care about the Aaronson-Ambainis conjecture in full generality anymore if we only care about the quantum part. If we only care about the quantum part, we just can propose another conjecture, which is the Aaronson-Ambainis conjecture for Fourier complete bounded polynomials, and see what can we prove with this. So just to be clear, the Aaronson-Ambainis conjecture implies this conjecture which is the same but for Fourier completely bounded polynomials, which is still interesting because it implies that exponential quantum speedups need a structure. And now I'm going to show how to sketch the proof of a particular case of this Aaronson-Ambainis conjecture for Fourier completely bounded polynomials. This particular case is the case of homogeneous Fourier completely bounded polynomials, which is particular, but if you know the literature on this topic, it's not that particular because the previous results of the Aaronson-Ambainis conjecture were super, super particular. You needed a lot of structure, and here we are just asking for the homogeneity of the polynomial. So I would argue that this is a particular case, but not that particular. Okay, so the thing is that if we have a homogeneous Fourier completely bounded polynomial, what we can do is to build a high-dimensional bit with this property, that it has in the numerator the Fourier coefficients and in the denominator the square root of the maximum influence. So now, if the polynomial is homogeneous, we can evaluate the Fourier completely bounded non-supremum on this high-dimensional bit. If we get that, we get now that this p get squared, and if you remember, this was the variance. So now we are going to get that the Fourier completely bounded norm is lower bounded by the variance divided by the square root of the maximum influence. And this is nice because if our Fourier completely bounded polynomial, if our polynomial is Fourier completely bounded, meaning that it comes from a quantum query algorithm, then after rearranging, we are going to get that the sorry. So yeah, if you look at this upper bound and you compare it with the lower bound, you are going to get that you can move the maximum influence here, you square everything, and you get that the maximum influence is lower bounded by the degree, which is what we wanted to show. We wanted to show that there is a influence that is big, that there is a variable who is responsible of a lot of the variance of the polynomial. So we have proved a particular case of the Aaronson-Ambainis conjecture. So to recap, I want to say that what we care about is if quantum speedups need a structure to be exponential. The way to prove that the community thinks is to show that the Aaronson-Ambainis conjecture is true. But what we have shown is that maybe we don't have to care about the Aaronson-Ambainis conjecture in full generality, but only about the particular case of Fourier completely bounded polynomials. We prove that conjecture for Fourier completely bounded polynomials that are also homogeneous. And we also improve the results of Bansal, Sinha, and the Wolf, giving a simpler proof that also obtains better constants. And that is all I wanted to say, so thanks a lot for listening.
Yeah, thank you very much. We have plenty of time for questions. Is there questions from the audience already? Ah, very good. Embedded throw.
Yeah, Fran, thanks for the talk. I didn't get clear what is structure in your talk. You said if they need structure or not. And could you clarify this concept?
Yeah, for me, a structure is just that the domain is very small. Like, yeah, in general, people say that the structure is having like some symmetry, but having some symmetry implies that your domain is going to be like pretty small. So you don't care about the whole Boolean hypercube.
Okay, just the size of the domain.
Yes.
Thank you.
More questions? Okay, maybe I have a technical question, or maybe two of them. Like, is this restriction to homogeneous polynomials severe, or can you use these usual tricks to represent every polynomial as a homogeneous polynomial?
No, that doesn't work because the thing is that it's not easy to relate, I'm hiding some technical details, and it's not easy to relate a homogeneous polynomial, a non-homogeneous polynomial to a homogeneous one. So yeah, I cannot really answer the question without going into the technical details, but the usual tricks that you can do to go from non-homogeneous to homogeneous don't work in this case.
Okay, and then maybe as a follow-up question, in order to solve the results, you change the norm, right? And what is the biggest difference between the Fourier completely bounded norm and the normal max norm?
I mean, the separations can be really big, and yeah. So maybe if you are familiar with the Grothendieck inequality, there is somehow the same. You are comparing the completely bounded norm with the infinity norm, and those two are equivalent when you have degree two. But when you have degree more than two, they are no longer equivalent, and you can have very big separations depending on the dimension, like polynomial.
Okay. Are there more questions from the audience, maybe? We have time. Guess you made everybody happy. Thank you very much.